Okay, so in this second lecture, I will still be speaking about the representation of fundamental group of a surface in this group PSL2R, and I would like to first recall what we did yesterday. So yesterday we introduced the so-called Fuchsian representations, which are the representations coming from a hyperbolic structure on the given surface. Namely, we take, as yesterday, S is a closed oriented surface of genus G, which is larger than or equal to 2. And we have a hyperbolic metric on that surface, namely a Riemannian metric of curvature minus 1, then we have an identification between the surface S and the quotient of the upper half plane by some group gamma of isometries of positive isometries of the upper half plane, which is our group PSL2R. And this gamma, in fact, is so acts freely and properly discontinuously on the upper half plane, and it identifies with the fundamental group of our surface. So this gives rise. So any such identifications, any hyperbolic structure on the surface, gives rise to representations from the fundamental group of S to PSL2R, which is just the identification between the fundamental group of S and the group gamma, this Fuchsian group. So in fact, these representations are called Fuchsian representations, and in fact, a representation from the fundamental group of a surface in PSL2R is Fuchsian if and only if it is faithful and with discrete image. The proof of that is that, in fact, the fundamental group of a surface, of a closed surface, determines the topology of the underlying surface. So you can detect, for instance, the genus of the surface by knowing the fundamental group of the surface. You just take the Abelianization, for instance, of the fundamental group, and you get the first homology of the surface, which is just a free Abelian group of rank 2G. So you recover the genus of your surface just looking at the fundamental. So in fact, let's say another characterization of Fuchsian representation is the following, as I said, representation is Fuchsian if and only if it is faithful and discrete. So by discrete, I mean that the image of the representation is a discrete subgroup of PSL2R with a natural topology on this Lie group, PSL2R. And as I said yesterday, we didn't really prove that, but it's not really hard to prove. It is equivalent, to be discrete, it is equivalent that the action of the group gamma on upper half plane is properly discontinuous. Okay. So we have seen yesterday that we have defined that yesterday, and we also have seen that in fact any complex structure on the surface S gives rise to a unique hyperbolic structure, and so to a unique representation of the fundamental group of S in PSL2R up to conjugation. But today I will not really, I will try to, I mean, unless for really small moment, I will forget the Teichmuller theory. I will really try to speak about hyperbolic geometry and representations of surface group. So what I want to begin with is to say that if we look at general representations of a surface group in PSL2R, there are no reason to be Fuchsian, of course. So for instance, if you take the trivial representation which maps any element of the fundamental group to the identity matrix, of course. So this is one example. Of course, it is kind of easy to build representation which are not faithful, for instance. You can, for instance, do the following procedure to build some representation which are not Fuchsians. You think of your surface as being the boundary of a handle body of genus G. You think of your surface S as being in three space like that, and you look at the interior of the region delimited by this surface. This is a handle body of genus G. And in fact, it is, let's call H the interior region in three space. And in fact, it is quite easy to prove that the fundamental group of H is a free group on G generators. And so this is the first thing. And that if you look at the natural map coming from inclusion of S as a boundary of handle body, so this map is a surjective map. So this proves that you can always surject the fundamental group of a surface onto a free group on G generators, where G is the genus. And now it is really easy to define representations of the surface group into PSL2R just by defining a representation from the fundamental group of the handle body and precomposing by this surjection. Okay, you will, in this procedure, build a representation of the surface group. And now why it is interesting, it is that to define a representation from a free group on G generators in PSL2R is extremely easy. You just have to specify G matrices, which will be the images of the generators of this free group. So you will have G times the number of parameters of this Lie group, namely three. So three G parameters for defining a representation from this group to PSL2R. So what I just wanted to say here is that by this procedure, you can construct a lot of representations from a surface to PSL2R. This is just a kind of easy example, just to say that there are representations from a surface to PSL2R that are not Fuchsian. So in this lecture, we will try to make a little, to organize a little bit this space. So the space of representation of the fundamental group of our surface in PSL2R, and so this is quite classical. So the main thing I am going to do is that I'm going to organize this space as a disjoint set of connected components. There will be a finite number of connected components, and each of these connected components will be detected by an invariant, which is called the volume of the representation. So I am going to define this volume. I am going to explain some obstructions that the volume of a representation can that the volume of a representation satisfies. And and at the end, I would like to try to speak about how we can come back to geometry from a representation which is not necessarily function, namely how we can try to geometrize representations. So this is more or less what I would like to speak about today. So first, let me try to define what is the volume of a representation. And so, this kind of really classical invariant, which goes back maybe to the 70s. So, what you try, so I say the word geometrization, that will be an important word for the end of the talk, but from now on still we will see that it appears in some ways. So we know from yesterday that a Fuchsian representation, we can associate to them a hyperbolic metric on the surface. And so in general, for a non-Fuchsian representation, of course, this will not be the case, as I said. But still, we can try to appeal to geometry. And how we will do that in really great generality, what I would like to say, what is a geometrization, it is going to be a map. So, so what I claim is that there always exists a map, let's say for now, continuous and even smooth, if you want, map. But I will consider also continuous maps. So I will stay in this category. For this generality, map from which is called a developing map, or which I will think of as a developing map, from the universal cover of our surface to upper half plane. So it is kind of a local identification of our surface with a upper half plane. So as in the case of a hyperbolic structure, but here I don't ask that it is a local diffeomorphism. I just have a continuous map, which is equivariant with respect to the representation rho. Okay. So I claim this is always possible to find such a map. So here's the proof. So the proof is take a triangulation of S, tau of S, and No. No, now I try to define the volume of any representation. Right. So take a triangulation of the surface, I denote it by tau, and lift it to the universal cover of S. So I denote by tau tilde. With tilde, I denote all the objects at the level of the universal cover. So we get, so if this, the interior of this disk is the universal, denotes the universal cover of our surface, we get a triangulation which will be invariant by the action of the fundamental group of our surface, right? Get a kind of tessellation, which is invariant by this action. And so what we will do, we just take for any vertex of our original triangulation, we lift this vertex. So for any P, we denote by P tilde a vertex of the lifted triangulation, which is the lift of P. So we have a finite number, because we have a finite triangulation on the surface, we have a finite number of points of vertices here, which form a kind of fundamental domain for the action of the fundamental group on the set of vertices at the level of the lifted triangulations. And now what we will do, we will define a map. So we want to define a map from the universal cover of our surface to the upper half plane. And we will do the following. So we for any P tilde that I just defined, so the finite numbers, we prescribe any value, so arbitrarily, any value for the map we want to construct. And now we extend the definition of our map to the set of all vertices by using equivariance. Okay, since we have taken a fundamental domain for the action on vertices, there is a unique way to do so. So this is maybe we prescribe, this is the first step. Second step, we extend D to the set of all vertices of this lifted triangulation using rho equivariance. Right? So if, for instance, I consider a vertex here, so it is a vertex that I denote by Q tilde, let's say. So this Q tilde is some element gamma of the fundamental group, the image of some elements P, of some vertex P tilde that I, in my fundamental domain, by an element of the fundamental group, and I just define the image of Q tilde is just rho of gamma times the image of P tilde that I already defined in the first step. Okay? So there is a unique way to do so. And now we have defined our map D on the set of vertices of the lifted triangulation, and we extend this map on the first skeleton, so on the edges, by sending any edge to the geodesic between the image of the extremities of the edge I consider, and then the interior of the two skeletons, so the faces of my triangulation, I extend the map so that it maps the triangle to the triangle in hyperbolic space, right? So to do this, I will not make this really precise. I just say that. So to do that really concretely, you have to also take a fundamental domain in the set of all edges in the lifted triangulation, define extensions of our map so that it becomes, the image becomes geodesic, and then extend by equivariance and do the same for the set of faces. Okay, but this is very simple procedure to prove the existence of such a developing map. Okay. So this is extremely simple, and in fact, it is also simple, I will not do so, to smooth such a map. So this map I just defined is kind of continuous only, but you can smooth such a map to get a smooth equivariant map to from the universal cover of your surface to the upper half plane. And so I'm going to erase this proof. And I want to say something before continuing, which is the following. So this is a first step towards the geometrization of our representation in the following sense. So here, for instance, so if you think of the proof before, so we have in fact founded for each triangle of our triangulation in our surface. So we can leave this triangle to the universal cover and look at the image of this triangle by our developing map we just constructed before, and we get a hyperbolic triangle. So in fact, for any triangle of, so it is well defined because it does not depend on the lift because of our triangle, because the map is equivariant. So the image of two lifts differ by an isometry of the upper half plane. So in fact, if we follow the proof we just done, so we had a triangulation of our surface, and each triangle is now equipped with a hyperbolic, a structure of a hyperbolic triangle. And more than that, we can also, we have another, an extra information, namely that this triangle has an orientation because our surface is oriented. So we can look at how it is mapped to the upper half plane. It is either mapped to the upper half plane with positive orientation or with negative orientation. And there are some degenerated cases where the triangle could be mapped to a degenerated triangle where we could not define orientation, but we will try to just don't think about these kind of degenerated cases, which are not generic. So in fact, we have kind of geometrized our representation in the sense that we have geometry on these triangles plus signs assigned to this triangle. So this is what this is the first attempt to get a geometrization of our representation. So of course here this geometrization will, in this generality, will not be really how to say, efficient for many problems. And all the game that we will try to develop in this lecture and tomorrow will be to try to find better geometrizations which enable to say something interesting on representations. But anyway, this is really the idea of what is a geometrization. Okay, so now let me define what is the volume. No. It is not at all canonical. So this map is not at all canonical. It depends. First, it depends on triangulation. Second, it depends on the first. So you had lift the vertices, and you might send the vertices anywhere you want. So there are this finite number of parameters which are not canonical. Okay. So it is not canonical. But it is canonical in a certain way. Let me say a property which is very important and which will serve for what will follow, is that the map D, the developing map, is well defined up to homotopy within the set of row equivalent map. So what I'm saying is that the set of row equivalent map, continuous row equivalent map, or smooth row equivalent map is connected. So in this sense, it is canonical. And the proof is extremely easy also. It's just if you have two maps. So here is the universal cover. You have a first map D and a second map D prime, which are both row equivalent, right? So if you take a point here, you look at, so you have two images, one by D and one the other one by D prime. And so you can define a map, a family of maps, so DT for T in the interval 0, 1, and in such a way that DT of P describe the geodesic segment between D of P and D prime of P parameterized by a length 1 interval, right? So you take the geodesics between the these two maps, and it defines for you so homotopy between D and D prime, and this homotopy is made of row equivalent maps because we have used geodesics which are invariant by the representations, and so these the maps DT are all row equivalent. Okay. So in a sense, in this sense, there exists a unique row equivalent map. Of course, as we will see, we will try to find more in this class of row equivalent map, in this class of developing map or geometrizations, we will try to find more interesting ones. But so now, let me define what is the volume. And for this, I will need to specify two maps which are either I will need to some regularities. So I'm going to use smooth maps or the maps that I have constructed in this. In the proof that there exists some developing map. So so what I claim is that if you take a developing map, you can look at the pre-image by our developing map of the so maybe I should say what is the idea here. So here you see we have constructed in the proof a geometric object made of the union of these hyperbolic triangles. Some are positive and some are negative. And in fact, we want to say that this geometric object has a volume, and this volume is just the sum of the volumes of the positive triangle minus the sum of the volumes of the negative triangles, right? And so this is perfectly, it makes perfectly good sense. And in fact, what is going to be true is that this invariant does not depend on the choice of the developing map. And in fact, it will take almost an integer value if you divide by 2 pi. So this is for this kind of developing map I have just defined here. But if you take any D, so more formally, if you take any D which is smooth, or I would like to say piecewise smooth, then you can look at the pre-image by D of the volume form associated to Poincaré metric. Right, and because this map is row equivalent, and that the volume is invariant by the action of the isometric group, this is going to be a form which is invariant by the action of the fundamental group. Okay, and so in fact, it is a form which lives on the surface S. So you can just integrate this form on the surface S. So now S is compact, so this is a real number, And the claim is that this V, which a priori will depend on D, does not depend on D. It only depends on on the representation rho. So this depends on the representation rho. This is why I denoted by V of rho. And I would like to also write some properties of this volume. Moreover, we have that 1 over 2 pi times the volume belongs to a finite set of integer values. So all the values, all the integer values which in modulus are less or equal to 2g minus 2, so the absolute value of the Euler characteristic of the surface. So what can I say? So this is called, this is called the Milner-Wood inequality. And it takes extremal values if and only if rho is Fuchsian or anti-Fuchsian. So what is the definition of anti-Fuchsian representation? We have defined what is a Fuchsian representation. So anti-Fuchsian representation is the same as a Fuchsian representation, but you just change the orientation of the surface. So you change the representation.
If you have a spatial representation, you have this bundle, right?
Right.
Is there other class of that related to that? Or?
This is the opposite of the volume. So this is the opposite of the volume. Okay, so this is, I will not really speak about this Euler class, but so to answer your question, of course, this is the opposite. It's the same. And so this this fact, so, sorry?
The Euler class, there's like the cohomology class.
Right.
This is like the value of that function.
So in fact, so I don't really get the question. So I repeat what I said maybe to Alberto. So this 1 over 2 pi times the volume is just the opposite of the Euler class of the circle bundle that you obtain by suspending the action of the representation on the circle. Projective action, there is a negative sign, right? Because, you know, for a Fuchsian representation, we know that this bundle has Euler class 2 minus 2g, and the volume, by definition, by my definition, is positive. But really, I want that the Fuchsian representation has volume 2g minus 2. So is it clear for everybody that the volume of a representation? So, okay, so let me just say a word. So here, this is a theorem proven by Goldman in his thesis in the beginning of the 80s or end of 70s, I don't know exactly. But so these two theorems belongs to the 70s, let's say, a little bit extended to.
Would you please explain the definition of the Euler class of anti-Fuchsian?
So anti-Fuchsian representation is the following. So you take a surface and you consider a Fuchsian representation. So it is an oriented surface, right? You take a hyperbolic structure on this surface, and you get a Fuchsian representation. But now you take the same surface, but you exchange the orientation, take the opposite orientation, and you keep the same representation. The same representation is no more Fuchsian. In fact, it is anti-Fuchsian. And one way to see that it is that this volume take the opposite value. So if you exchange your orientation on your surface and keep the same representation, the volume changes size. Sign. Okay. Sorry?
What's the necessity of the definition of anti?
Because an anti-Fuchsian is different from a Fuchsian representation. You can see that by just looking at the volume. So I will. So, yeah. So it seems like the same representation, but in fact, right, that's right. This is the same. Right. This is. Have you heard? So what was said is that I don't know if you. So what was said is that an anti-Fuchsian. Another definition for anti-Fuchsian is that you take a Fuchsian representation and you take a conjugate of this Fuchsian representation. Not by an element of PSL2R, you would get a Fuchsian, but by an element of an isometry which reverses orientation. So an element of PGL2R. And then you get an anti-Fuchsian representation. So PGL2R adds also, so maybe, right? I mean, just forget about PGL2R. An isometry which reverses orientation. Now I have a doubt if it's, just forget. Right, so yeah, right. So yeah, so my doubt was true. Anyway, so is this okay? So what I so just to understand well, I mean the easy part in Goldman theorem is the fact that if you have a Fuchsian representation, then its volume is 2g minus 2. Right, so the volume of rho is equal to 2g minus 2 if rho is Fuchsian. Well, this is really easy because we have, by definition, we have a hyperbolic structure on our surface, and this hyperbolic structure gives rise to an identification of the universal cover of our surface with upper half plane, which will be equivalent with respect to our Fuchsian representation. And this diffeomorphism between universal cover of the surface and upper half plane is a positive diffeomorphism. So then the volume of the representation is just the volume of our hyperbolic surface. By Gauss-Bonnet, it is just 2g minus 2. So sorry. 2g minus 2 times 2 pi by Gauss-Bonnet. So it is this statement is just Gauss-Bonnet theorem. And but the opposite statement is more difficult. I hope I mean we will give a proof of this of the opposite statement, which is really Goldman theorem, tomorrow. Today I would like to give a proof for all the other statements, namely that the 1 over 2 pi times the volume of a representation can only take this set of values, and that we and that's it.
Is it possible to get both values?
To get what?
Is it possible to get representations that attain every value?
Right. Right. This is so. I will not write it, but each of these values occurs as 1/2 pi times the volume of a representation, a certain representation. Okay. Right. We will see that. Right. Zero is attained. 2g minus 2 is attained. So we will see in a moment that we can do any value. Okay, so let's go. Let's go to prove first. So what I am going to do to prove this theorem is to prove that first that 1/2 pi times the volume is always integer. It's always an integer. And to do so, I am going to use. So In fact, now we don't really know that it does not depend on on the equivariant map D. But what I am going to do is that I am going to prove that for any of these maps, this integral takes an integer value. And so because they are all homotopic, this volume is going to be constant and not depending on the representation. And to do so, I will only give the proof in the case of the developing map I already constructed in the proof that there exists. So namely, in this kind of geometrization by positive and or negative triangles. So here is our surface. And this surface is triangulated by hyperbolic triangles. I'm going to assume that none of these triangles are degenerate. And so there are some parts which are positive of the surface. So some triangles are positive, and some other ones are negative. So it defines for me some regions of the surface that I am going to call. So in the red, this is, say, positive ones. In the blue, it is negative regions, right? And I'm going to denote S plus the union of the triangles which are positive, and S minus the union of the triangles of our triangle relation which are negative. And now what I want to do is to mimic what I just said, that the volume of the fiction, the proof that the volume of the fiction representation is over 2 pi is 2g minus 2. So we will, to do so, we will just apply Gauss-Bonnet theorem to each connected component of the regions S plus or S minus. Okay? So what I have to do is to apply Gauss-Bonnet to some. So if I take a connected component of S plus or S minus, it is, so in fact, to be really precise, what I do is that I consider a connected component of the interior of S plus or S minus, and then I take the geometric completion. But just forget about these things. What if I have a surface with boundaries, and the surface is a hyperbolic surface, and the boundaries is piecewise geodesic? So how do we apply Gauss-Bonnet theorem for such? So let D be a hyperbolic surface, hyperbolic meaning remanent surface of curvature minus 1, so a compact hyperbolic surface with a piecewise geodesic boundary. But so let's say it is a connected, or it is not really necessary here. So what is so if we look at the boundary, then it is going to look as something like this. So we will have a curve. So assume, say, our surface lives on this side of the boundary. So we have our domain here. So this domain, it could have topology in our setting. But so what will be important in the Gauss-Bonnet theorem is to consider the external angles. If we take P, a point in the boundary, which is a corner, we have an angle, let's say alpha of P, which is the the angle of the surface. So the conical corner angle, maybe, I don't know what is the terminology, corner angle of the surface of the domain D at P. And so Gauss-Bonnet theorem says that if we consider minus the volume of D plus sum of this angle alpha of P minus P for any P in the set of corner points in the boundary, then we get that this is equal to 2 pi times the Euler characteristic of our domain D. Right? Is it okay or? So this is a curvature term of the boundary. Okay, we have no curvature term coming from the point which are not corner point because those segments are geodesic ones, but we have only this kind of terms which occurs. Okay, so now I can write this formula. Use this formula for the two surfaces S plus and S minus. So I get volume of the developing map I was just constructing is by definition of the volume is just the volume of S plus minus the volume of S minus. And I will try to make the proof here. So this is 2 pi times the Euler characteristic of S plus minus the Euler characteristic of S minus, right? So this is an integer, so we are okay. And now there are the boundary terms coming from the corner points. So let's analyze what happens there. So we have, we have some at the corner points, positive corner points of minus the sum at the negative corner points, right, in this way. Okay, so now in this sum, we can try to block this sum into all the points, a sum on all the vertices of our triangulation of these quantities. So this will give, if we try to look at all the these corner points coming from a single vertex of our original triangulation, we will see successively a corner, negative corner point, then a positive one, and then a negative one, etc. Like that. Right. So we, if here we have a vertex of our triangulation, in this double sum, I will see for each conical domain getting out of this point, I will see some terms appearing. And what are these terms? Well, if I don't know this. Is going to count by negative terms, so it will be something like alpha of p minus if this is. So let's maybe call this point p1 plus, p1 minus. No, this is p1 minus, p1 plus, p2 minus, p2 plus, etc. There will be an even number of domains because they are. Because this is clear, I don't know how to say. And then in the sum we will have. So I'm sorry, it's a kind of. We will have so sum over alpha of p k plus minus pi minus alpha of p k minus pi. So the pi are going to cancel out. And we get the, as a result, we get the sum of the alpha of pk plus minus the sum of alpha of pk minus. minus, right? So, and then to get this double sum, we have to sum these sums over all the vertices of our triangulation. But now, what I claim is that this quantity, for any vertex, this quantity is an integer. And this is really clear because around this vertex, we have a developing map, local developing map, which is defined, which is going to map the red region positively, and then the blue region in negative sense. So we have to so if we are in the red region, we turn the anti-clockwise orientation, and then in the blue region, clockwise orientation. But we have to come back at the same value because the map is well defined. So in fact, the sine sum has to be an integer. Right? So each of these is an integer, and so this ends the proof that this volume takes an integer value. So it is constant and does not depend on the developing map, since the sets of developing maps is connected. Okay? Okay. So after this painful proof, we will go on to prove that 1 over 2 pi times the volume is bounded in absolute value by 2g minus 2. So this is what is called the Milne-Norwood inequality. I have to hurry if I want to speak, to give some examples. So I will try to. Proof of Milne-Norwood inequality. So the proof of Milne-Norwood inequality starts with the following very simple observation. Is that so? We will use. So we now know that the volume does not depend on the geometrization we have chosen. So we can try to use the geometrization I defined at the beginning of the talk, namely those made of hyperpositive or negative triangles. So now suppose you have such a geometrization by positive or negative triangles. What I claim is that the volume of the representation is always, let's do this. So, yeah. So the volume of the representation is just, in absolute value, is just the absolute value of the sum of the array of the positive triangles. Minus the sum of the array of the negative triangles. Okay, so this is certainly bounded by the sum of the array of all the triangles. And as you probably know, or probably we will see in François' lecture, maybe, is that the array of a hyperbolic triangle is just pi minus the sum of the angles of the triangles. In particular, it is bounded by pi. So we get a bound for the volume, which is pi times the number of triangles which we need to triangulate the surface S. Right. So this bound here does not depend on the representation. So this is the first step in Milne-Norwood inequality. So what is a kind of good triangulation? I mean, an efficient triangulation of a surface is let's say Riemann's triangulation. I don't know if it is really him, but anyway. So this is, you know, you consider these curves starting from one point. So this is, you first consider a point in the surface, and you consider these curves. So this is in the case of genus 2. And if you cut along this curve, you get, as you probably know, this octagon. Okay. Right? So to go back to the surface, you have to identify this and this with negative diffeomorphism, this and this, and right? You probably all know this construction. And so now you can get a triangulation of this surface by just triangulating this region, right? And so here in this genus 2 example, you get 6 triangles, right? So you get that the volume of a representation in genus 2 is always bounded by pi times 6, OK? But in general, if you have a genus G surface, you will get a 4G gone here. And you will get, if I'm not mistaken, 4G minus 2 triangles. So this bounds gives you that the norm of the volume is less than pi times 4G minus 2. So this is not what we want, because we want 4G minus 4, right? So the trick here is to do the the following construction, to remark that the volume of a representation has a multiplicative property with respect to taking a covering of a surface, a non-ramified covering of the surface. So this is a kind of extremely classical trick, but which will give the result here. So what I claim is the following, is that if you take your surface and you take a D21 that I am going to call P, non-ramified covering finite above our surface S, okay, then you can consider the representation rho prime from the fundamental group of S prime to PSL 2R, which is just the composition of the map from the fundamental group of S prime to fundamental group of S, and which goes then to PSL 2R via the representation, our original representation rho, right? So you can restrict, in a sense, this is an injection, you can restrict your representation to the fundamental group of covering of the finite covering of the surface. And what I claim, this is evident, is that the volume of rho prime is just degree of the covering, namely d, it was the degree of the covering, times the volume of rho. Right? So I can apply this bound for this for the restriction of the representation on the fundamental group of the covering, namely, volume of rho prime is less than pi times 4g prime minus 2, where g prime is the genus of s prime, right? But if you consider the quantity 4g prime minus 4, this is two times a Laplace characteristic of s prime, and this is multiplicative. So this is d times 4g minus 4. So we get here that this is pi times d times 4g. Sorry. Yeah, up minus 4 plus 2. Right? And so if I want. Is it okay? This is okay, I think. Right? And so I am not interested in the volume of rho prime. I am interested in the volume of rho. So this is just this divided by d, by this formula. So we divide everything by D. So here the D cancels. We get this bound. So, and taking D to infinity, we get the Milner-Wood inequality that we wanted to prove. Okay, so so this is a proof of the Milner-Wood inequality. And I have approximately 10 minutes to left to talk more precisely about geometrizations, so maybe efficient geometrization of surfaces. So let me give two examples of geometrizations. Which, as we will see tomorrow, will be very efficient for certain problems of dominations. So first example is geometrization by foldings. In a sense, we already know what so our geometrization was really made by foldings. So we had positive and negative triangles, and between a positive and a negative one, the developing map folds is really a folding. So in a sense, we have already seen that you have to think that. Let's try it. I will try to make a picture. So. I'm going to try to make a picture of the developing map. So if you have in our surface two triangles, one is positive, the other one is negative, what is doing the developing map? It is just mapping the red triangle isometrically and positively into upper half plane. And the blue one, it maps negatively. So you see a kind of overlapping of the two triangles, namely a folding appearing for the developing map. Okay, so we already saw that. But there are some foldings which are really much more interesting and efficient, which are foldings which only occurs along geodesics. So what happens here is that you see the folding I just draw occurs along a geodesic, but what happens at a vertex, it's much more complicated because you have successively positive and negative regions and you fold a certain number of times. So here you have a complicated combinatorics appearing at the vertices. So these kind of things we don't want in the geometrization I am going to describe. And so I'm going to introduce some geometrization which has been developed by Thurston in the context of, in fact, representation of surface groups in hyperbolic spaces in general, which is the following. So the definition is the following. This is a developing, so this is a rho equivalent map. D, so again from universal cover of the surface to upper half plane, which is an isometric, so which is continuous, and is an isometric embeddings. In a restriction to any exterior component of the lift of an invariant geodesic lamination. So a P1 pi one of S invariant geodesic lamination. So this geodesic lamination is taken with respect to a certain hyperbolic structure. On S, and consequently on the universal cover of S. So let me give some comments on this definition. So what is so if you have a hyperbolic structure given on your surface, so the universal cover of the surface is just identified with the upper half plane, and a geodesic lamination is just a closed subset, which is a disjoint union of geodesics. So I don't know, maybe something like this. So there is an infinite number of geodesics, maybe even uncountably many geodesics. But this is a closed subset. I'm going to denote it by maybe lambda tilde. So this is the lamination. And so what we will ask is that in the complementary region of this lamination, which is a certain domain with geodesic boundary, we want that the map D is just an isometric embedding, so it is a restriction of a map of PSL to R. Okay? But the maps can... An isometric embedding, so I say the mistake, of course. So we want it is isometric, but we don't ask it preserves orientation. It can fold, of course. It is called a folding. So there are some regions which are mapped isometrically but with positive orientation, other ones which are mapped with negative orientation, exactly as we described here. And in fact, there is a... So those are important geometrizations of surfaces. And in fact, there is a recent result by François Guérito, Fanny Cassel, and Maxime Wolf, building on works of maybe Gallo-Kapovich-Marden, which shows that any representation apart from representation can be I don't know what would be the good word in English. I think you understand. So by a folding. So any representation, it is not always true. For instance, identity representation will not work. In fact, any representation which is different to an abelian, a virtually abelian representation. Abelian representation means a representation with abelian image in PSL to R, and virtually means up to a finite indexable. So this is a very nice theorem, which is quite recent, maybe 2013, maybe. And it builds on works by Gallo-Kapovich-Marden, where they proved a similar statement for representation with even Euler class. So we prove the same statement for non-elementary representation with even Euler classes, I mean, with even volume, with even V of O over 2 pi. Okay, but in their approach, they really get something which is fold only along a finite number of simple closed geodesics. but you can prove, it's a kind of easy exercise to prove that you cannot geometrize a representation whose volume over 2 pi is odd by a folding along simple closed geodesics. It's not possible. It's a kind of easy exercise that you can do by looking at the positive and negative regions on the surface. And let me just finish by giving the example. Maybe I will do that tomorrow. because I will be out of time if I do so. So tomorrow I will begin by another kind of geometrization, which is much more in the spirit of Teichmuller theory, and in the spirit of what we have seen yesterday, that will answer your question a lot for yesterday. So I will begin with this, and then I'm going to speak about domination of representations. Thank you.